I want to touch on particle size. So someone might put forth, well, you know, total number is this, but let's consider the composition of those particles. And they might go on further to posit that, well, larger particles are less likely to be trapped within the arterial wall compared to small dense particles. So for that reason, if total number is high, but it's mostly large, we don't have to worry so much about the entrapped and hence less overall risk. But it's a little more complicated than that. There, like most claims, right? There's some truth in there, but it doesn't exactly cover the whole story.
Yeah, I think that's accurate. So I don't blame people for thinking that. And it's not entirely unreasonable. When you look at the observational evidence, again, that first pillar that we talked about, you do see a correlation between particle size and risk. And like you said, people who have lower or smaller particles, smaller LDLs, tend to have higher risk. So it would be suggestive that would be protective. The problem is the observational stuff alone, it can be misleading. So we need to do more confirmation. And so we have the same problem, is that these metrics all vary together. Like, it's called collinearity, right? If you think about it, there's no way to change particle size by itself without changing other metrics. It's not possible. If you take larger LDLs and you reduce them, you're necessarily trafficking around less cholesterol. So your LDL cholesterol goes down. Or if you want to keep LDL cholesterol constant and reduce particle size, you have to increase particle number, right? So you're always stuck, because you're always, to change one thing, you have to change something else. It's just like the buses. If you reduce the number of buses traveling around at a certain time, you have less passengers traveling inside those buses. And if you want to leave that number of passengers constant and you want to build smaller buses, now you need more buses to carry all those people. So because of this reason, you need to do a further analysis to kind of untangle the different parameters, the different confounders. And so when you do multivariate analysis on the observational data, what you see is that when you adjust for the content of the particles and for the number of the particles, the effect of the particle size generally tends to go away. Most of the analyses show that. And then you can confirm that with the genetics. Same thing, you can look at which metric tracks best. Is it genetically determined lower size, or genetically determined content, or genetically determined particle number? And again, you find that the risk tracks best with particle number, with ApoB. And in fact, one thing that's come out recently in the last couple of years out of these genetic studies that's really tantalizing is that even VLDLs, which are by definition much larger than the largest LDLs, right? Even VLDLs are atherogenic, and it's now thought that they're equally atherogenic to LDLs. So all of the ApoB carrying lipoproteins, they represent roughly the same risk. Now, I'm not saying total LDLs versus total VLDLs, because the number, as we said previously, is very different, but particle by particle, they're equally atherogenic. So each VLDL to each LDL. And there's some speculation on why that would be and the mechanisms behind that. We can touch on that if you want. But if this is coming out of the genetics, that even VLDLs that are much larger are equally atherogenic, to posit that larger LDLs, which are kind of intermediate, you'd have to wrap around your head around the fact that, you know, risk goes up and then goes down again. It has nothing to do with size anymore, right? It's no longer explained by size. But basically, yeah, it doesn't, when you do these more detailed analyses where you try to uncouple the different factors, the particle size doesn't seem to play much of a role. Now, if people are in love with the particle size, and if they have a way to increase their particle size, I haven't seen any evidence that that's detrimental, provided that you're not doing that at the expense of increasing particle number. That's the critical caveat, right? Because that would be jumping from the pan to the fire. So if you have a way to increase your particle size, but leave your particle number constant or bring it down, I don't see a problem, you know, off the top of my head. But to suggest that having increased ApoB is okay because the particles are larger, the bulk of the evidence is just not pointing in that direction. It's pointing in the opposite direction. So I would alert people to heed ApoB and focus on that in terms of protecting themselves and lowering their risk. Say.